This is Clinton Callahan here in Mill Valley, California. We have the rare and wonderful opportunity to talk to John Welwood, who is a transpersonal psychologist and the inventor, one of the co-inventors of the field, I would say, and a leader in human potential movement and a longtime favorite person of mine. So I'm very happy to get to talk to John here today. And thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm going to ask you some questions. Is that okay?
Yeah.
I'm fascinated and troubled by the problem of a human being becoming more in alignment with themselves, having to face a kind of stage of chaos in their inner world. And somehow you've been able to make it safe for people to do that personal development work for a long time and feel safe and kind of okay with the chaos. Can you just talk about how you do that?
Well, I don't use the word chaos so much, but I already work with relating to the unknown, which I guess provokes inner chaos in a sense, because people can't trying to grasp onto the unknown with their concepts or their memory or their belief, and then it becomes chaotic. But the starting point, in a way, is recognizing that our beliefs and concepts and mental activity do not really capture the nature of reality. They don't capture anything except a conceptual world. And we can live in that conceptual world our whole life. Most people do that. And at some point, if you're fortunate enough, something, reality breaks through that mental world, this self-created world, and we realize that life's much bigger than anything we can think about it or think about ourselves. So then we're in touch with the unknown. And you know, you could make a big metaphysical thing out of the unknown, and you could call it God or the mystery. But I try to take it down to very simple terms, which is when we're actually relating to our own experience in the present moment, we don't know what's happening. It's just the nature of it, nature of the beast. If I think I know what's happening in my experience right now, then I'm laying my belief on it or my concept on it. But actually, in order to come into relationship with my present experience, whatever it is, at any given moment at all, whether it's profound or just superficial, in order to make contact with it and interact with it and have it be a living flow process of experiencing is leading somewhere new, I have to approach it with the humility of actually recognizing that I don't know where I am right now, with my mind at least. And then it's possible that I can start to come into a relationship freshly in this moment with where I am. But the first step of that has to be recognizing that not knowing as the ground and honoring that that's the entry point. If I recognize I don't know, as for example right now, I don't know what I'm going to say next. I don't know what I'm saying right now until it's said. Therefore, I'm the learner. I'm not like a leader. I'm not like cooking it up in my brain and then reading it off a teleprompter and delivering it. I'm actually surprised to find out what I'm saying, actually, because it's not pre-planned. And that's how experience works. It unfolds through the interaction of your attention and some basic experiential process that is implicit. Implicit literally means folded in, plié from French, enfolded in on itself. And it needs our consciousness to unfold, to manifest, to become articulated. And then we stand back and say, wow, I just articulated something very interesting. But we are then the receiver, we're the recipient, we're the invited party to come in and actually witness and participate in the birth of our own experiencing process, coming to the fruition of articulation at every given moment. So this is how we can work with feeling, with or creative thinking of any kind. It always works like this, of like entering the door of the mystery with folded hands, a sense of honoring the mystery not being some metaphysical secret, but just the mystery of the freshness of our experience being alive at every moment and not being able to be captured in words beforehand. And the words are always like following the thread of the experiential stream. I call it the life stream. The life stream is what I call the flow of present experiencing. And then by getting on board that flow, we're in the life stream, we're in our life, and we can see where it's leading, the next, wherever it leads.
How does somebody apprentice to that? And how does somebody shift, go over the bridge from the kind of schooling we've had that was damaged and cut off our imagination and cut off our presence and being? And how does a person deal with a conflict between what their parents might hold to be true and what society holds to be true and what they're actually discovering through this kind of process? How does that happen?
Well, I work a lot with feeling, and it's all contained in feeling. In other words, if you feel in some way that you're not connected to the environment or the social situation or your family or the culture that you're living in, you actually feel it in your body. You actually can feel, it's not like an emotion, but there's more subtle forms of feeling. I like to say that, like, feeling is actually, we could talk about particular feelings like sadness or anxiety or anticipation or so forth. There are particular feelings which are like nouns. They're states of feeling. And there's also a process of feeling as a verb. So feeling the verb is the ongoing process of our life as we can experience it. So feeling is a way of experientially knowing where we are. Not conceptually knowing where we are, but it's a kind of felt knowing. So it's the felt knowing that's going to guide us. But we need to, again, need to be able to relate to that through the doorway of not knowing and receiving and actually paying and tuning in without an agenda, without a goal, without judgment, and seeing what wants to be revealed there. What's speaking to us, even though it doesn't yet have words. It's pre-verbal. It's the beauty of felt experiencing is that it's mostly pre-verbal. And the words are just helpers, you know, along the way to unpack it. The word I use a lot is unpacking it. Unpacking the implicit felt sense, the implicit feeling that's there. And then that is the guide. So feeling is an attunement. It's like a resonant, responsive attunement to the world, to our life, to ourselves, and to other people. Feeling is happening all the time. We actually feel everything. Everything in our life we feel. And it has an effect on us.
The only way I could imagine you continuing in that direction for all these years and being really leading and kind of paving paths or opening doors, or the only way I could imagine you could do that is by having some kind of a vision that it's possible for human beings to actually even have a society or multiple facets of different societies collaborating, but it's part of the vision of what a human being is and also what a society of human beings is in a mature, developed presence in the earth. Could you just talk about that vision that you have? You must be holding some vision about that.
Well, I think the key word, the operative word, is connection, connectedness. So mostly our world is run and populated by people whose mind is disconnected from what? From the body, from the senses, from feeling, from nature, from the earth, from the cosmos, from the heart, from the soul, from the spirit, from the divine guidance that comes through our body as felt, as feeling. So we live in a world of a disconnected mind, and that disconnected mind is like become like Frankenstein. It's a mental creation that's sort of running wild, running amok in the world, and is very destructive. So my vision is like to heal the outer ecology. And obviously, we can't live as human beings if the outer ecology isn't healthy. We need a new inner ecology. The outer ecology is not going to be salvaged through technocrats who are operating from the disconnected mind. And Obama is a technocrat like that, as was Clinton, as all the people who rise to the top of the ladder. They have to come from disconnected mind, because that's what's operating in the culture. And then the best they provide is some technical solutions. And those technical solutions are never going to work because they're coming from the disconnected mind. And so what has to happen is a transformation of humanity so that actually we come back into connectedness with everything. And that's a different kind of mind. That's the balanced, that's called awareness, or consciousness we could call it, or presence. And it's all about coming back into connection with ourselves, with who we really are, with our life of feeling, with our belly, with our heart, with our awareness, with the subtle body, with the gross physical body, with the cosmos, with reality all together. So my vision is about reconnecting. And connecting in a new way, really, actually, because it's now being done more consciously. There have been tribal societies that have developed certain kinds of connection, like connection to the earth, or connection to shamanic realities. But what we have the possibility of doing is being connected all together on all levels. And we're all of us who are working in these fields are mining different aspects of connectedness, different facets, different entry points into that.
You just mentioned the word possibility. You said what we have the possibility of. Could you just talk more about what we have the possibilities of?
Well, I think I just said it really. It's mostly about connection with ourselves, with the environment that we live in, with the earth underneath us, with the sky above us, and all the energies of the cosmos that rain down on us. So the possibility is to be fully human. And again, different societies and tribes and cultures in the world have developed different aspects of being human. You know, the East has developed certain aspects, Asia has developed certain aspects that are different from what the West has developed. And the possibility is that we could become whole human beings that are really connected on all the different levels, not just transcendence. I mean, some spiritual cultures have gone for transcendence. Some have gone more for just being connected to the earth. I think, you know, it's like we've all the cultures and visionaries of all time have come in with some angle and some particular, and right now we have the incredible luxury and great fortune of having access to all of these teachings that have accumulated over thousands of years and that are still alive and growing today. That is amazing. So that the potential we have is to actually tune in to connectedness at all levels and develop a completeness, become the complete human being. And then I see here the human being as opposed to just the transcendental being as always in relationship. So to be human is to be in relatedness, is to be in relationship, to be relational. And of course, human relationships are a major part of that, but it's also a relationship to ourselves and the cosmos. And that's I think, the possibility.
If you were to describe yourself or regard yourself as a member of a different culture, of a new culture, how would you describe that culture, how it works? You see?
You know, it, I so feel like we're not there yet on a collective level that I don't. Again, it's a little too in the future for me to answer that question. I don't know what's going to emerge. I don't know how it's going to emerge. I don't know if it's going to emerge. So to me, it would be a little speculative, and I tend not to deal in speculation. So I don't think I can answer that, actually.
You've worked with many, many people over many years. How would you wish people to approach this kind of work? How would you wish people, how can you, like, you know, your best students or the people who make most use of what you offer, what are their qualities or what are the hints for people to have success along the path of evolution? Can you talk about that?
What are the...
You've had many different students, apprentices, however you want to call them, associates, however you want to call it. But some are successful. You know, some really get it. What are the qualities of people that kind of pick it up and run with it?
Well, they have a hunger. The term for hunger is longing. And longing comes from the heart. And longing is related to devotion. So if you feel it, so, and then it gives birth to intention. So my sense of that is the lineage goes, longing leads to devotion. What are you longing for? Longing comes from the heart. See what you're longing for. What is it? Some people might just be connectedness. It might be love. It might be truth. It might be wisdom. It might be presence, greater presence. It might be just feeling more alive, feeling more healthy, something. So there's a longing that comes from the place where we actually feel we're missing something. So we have to, first of all, feel the suffering and pain of lacking something, being willing. So be willing to, instead of unconsciously suffering, consciously suffering, where we're cut off, where we're disconnected, because that always feels like suffering. It always feels like dis-ease. So going there, feeling, being willing to feel where we're not whole. From that, letting longing arise, from the longing, having devotion to that possibility, that potential inside us. From that, devotion, giving birth to intention. This is where I want to go. This is how I want to go. This is where I need to go. This is where I will go. So it goes like that.
Over the years, of course, longing could develop or could evolve. Could you talk any about the course of your longing, how it's evolved or your developing, how that has gone?
Well, originally I was longing in my 20s just for some form of meaningful connection to life, to my life and to life in general. I grew up in the suburbs of Boston and very materialistic world. It was completely meaningless to me, I must say. And I got involved in existentialism as a way of, this was in the 60s, that was the thing that was happening at the time before anything much else got it started in the way of the 60s. And just looking for meaning, what was meaningful, what's a meaningful life? So just longing for a meaningful life, I think was where I started from. And not seeing it around me and in the environment at all, and not seeing any guidance. And then I started to encounter Zen Buddhism in the 60s through Alan Watts and D.T. Suzuki. And then that seemed even more meaningful than existentialism, because it was talking about our true nature and waking up, which seemed, and the problem wasn't really that the world was meaningless, but that the problem was the nature of ourself, the separate self. And that's what was creating the lack of meaning, because it was disconnected from the bounty of our true nature, the bountiful quality of our true nature. And so then my longing became for that waking up quality. And then I also was very aware of my own psychological disconnections. And through Alan Watts' book, Psychotherapy East and West, he kind of put together the psychological work with the awakening work. And to me, that just seemed like, I just blew my mind completely. It was like, it just, a whole world opened up. My whole path started from that. And so there was a longing for not just, because Zen Buddhism was very beautiful and wonderful, but it was very Asian. And the psychological work was very Western. And I just wanted to bring those things together, because I wanted to be able to understand the Buddhist path or the transform awakening path in a way that was really native to my own upbringing and my roots, the cultural roots. And so I started to have a passion for bringing together the teachings of the East and the West. And so I went to graduate school in psychology and became a student of Eugene Gendlin, who was at the University of Chicago. And he was talking about felt experience. And that to me was like, just opened up a whole world. Because I didn't, at that point, I have to say, up until then, I really didn't know anything about feeling or about feelings either. And how to relate to them. And it's just like a sort of an entry point into that whole world. And then I started to develop the question, and which was a source of a lot of longing, of like, is the kind of change that happens through psychological work and psychotherapy the same as that happens on the spiritual path, or is it different? Or there's one a stage and another a different stage? Are they different ways of talking about the same thing? What are the relationship? Because I knew them both a little bit, one through meditation and one through psychology, that they knew that they both had something to offer, but I didn't know what the connection was between them. And that question has lived with me up until now, this very date, actually, and I continue to explore it. And then at some point along the way, I also brought in the level of, I realized on the spiritual path and spiritual practice that I was doing that practice in a somewhat disembodied way. It was more like happening from the mind. And I realized I wasn't very connected to my body, and I didn't know much about the body from within. And that started a whole other journey of exploring the body, the lived body, the body as it lived from within and felt from within, which is how I define the subtle body. The physical body being the outer body, the inner body being the lived body, the felt body, the body experienced from within. And so I realized I had a whole journey to make in terms of connecting with the subtle body, the felt body. And so I brought that in. So now it's all together, it started to become then how to integrate spiritual work, meditation work, with psychological healing work, with embodiment work, and how those three go together. And that's kind of where I am now in my path, working with all three of those.
I'm just really glad to hear you speak so clearly about the fact that your life, you've been on this journey, and still today, where are you? You're on the journey. Yeah. And I think people expect initiation or enlightenment to be a one step, you know, one of those fast food shops, you know, or a shopping mall. You walk in, get all your stuff, go home, and that's it. And could you just talk about the ongoingness somehow of initiation or just like that?
Well, the word journey captures the whole thing, really. A life is a journey. You know, here we are today. Where are we going from here? We don't know. You know, just the fact that we don't know where we're going to go for next moment, next day, next year, means it's a journey. We have to surrender to the journey, because it is a journey. Life is a journey. If it's not a journey, then it's something wrapped up in a package. It's a box that's defined and closed. So the word journey to me captures the whole thing. That is what life is. That is what the spiritual path is. That is what wisdom is making that journey. It's, you never arrive at a final stage. There is no cookie in the sky, great cookie. you know, even the great beings that I met who are quite awake say the same thing. They're still on the journey. I mean, even if you're fully awake in terms of your own being and your own connectedness, how to manifest that in the world is still going to be a journey. And how to teach people is going to be a journey. And how to bring them along and how to offer it fully into this culture and so forth. Those are all going to be further journeys. It's going to go on and on and on.
I just want to thank you for what you've given to me and many other people of being willing to write your books and give classes and leave a trail of where did John Welwood go? You know, how can we, these little hints are just so useful. Who made, you already talked about that actually, who made the hints for you. Really. I just want to say thank you. So thanks very much.
I always say I teach what I need to learn.
You say that. Say it in there.
I always say that I teach what I need to learn. It's, I mean, not everyone's like that. Some people teach what they've already completely digested and integrated. But for me, I teach what I need to learn. I write what I need to read. So my process is very much connected to the process of sharing it with others.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's how it has to go. I mean, it's,
keeps it alive.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, great.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
It was great.